Hi there and welcome to my kitchen. I'm Elizabeth from TotalWellnessHealthCoaching.com. I'm a functional medicine health coach. Total Wellness Health Coaching is where you can find me. It's where you can find these recipes and all sorts of tips about living the functional medicine life, which is, in a nutshell, functional medicine is where we look for the root cause rather than simply throwing medicine at symptoms. We figure out, why are you having those symptoms in the first place? And then the first line of defense is lifestyle. So it's diet and exercise and sleep and stress management and all that stuff. And a big part of that is diet. It's the food. And so way back when I started my first blog, Our Paleo Family, I think like 7 years ago, I started showing you how to make the foods that I was learning how to make for my family, because I knew we needed to still eat really good tasting food, but it had to fit this framework that I was trying to use to heal myself from autoimmune disease. So that's what I do. And today we're getting close to the Super Bowl, so I thought I'd show you something fun for all times of year, but extra fun for Super Bowl time, and that is soft pretzels. So these are not just gluten-free. These are not just dairy-free. These are actually paleo, which means they are grain-free. Grain-free baking has come a long way in the 10 years or so since I've been doing it. We used to have basically nut flours and arrowroot tapioca. We have all sorts of different flours now, and this particular recipe uses three different ones. We have almond, we have tapioca, and then this is cassava. Cassava is a root. So gluten-free baking, you're going to have a lot of rice and potato and things like that. With paleo, we're not using any of those grains. So remember, corn, rice, those are all grains. So these are paleo, which means they're also dairy-free, and they're super, super good. They're really good. We're actually having these because one of my kids has been begging for them. And so I thought, hey, that'd be a great thing to show you, because it's a little bit tricky. It's not hard, but it's just a teeny bit of a process. And trying to write up the explanation of how to twist dough into the shape of a pretzel is very difficult. So I'm going to show you. Now, this particular recipe, we're going to weigh our dry ingredients just because I want it to be super precise. Let me show you this. This is actually, I think, the Biggest Loser. It's Taylor brand. It just says Biggest Loser right there. I bought this at one of those kind of big box kitchen stores a long time ago. So I can link to one that is similar. I found one similar on Amazon. It has two buttons, on and tear, T-A-R-E, which basically zeroes it out, and then units. So this one will measure in ounces or grams. So I'm going to put my bowl on here, and I'm going to tear it. So I'm going to, essentially that's telling my scale my bowl weighs nothing. And I want 240 grams of almond flour and 240 grams of tapioca. It's just way more precise. Whoops, I need grams, sorry. Than measuring cups. If you were just going to measure and not use the scale, I'm not going to write it up this way, but I'm going to tell it to you now as you're following along. That was just under 2 cups of the almond flour. Now for the tapioca, we want the same 200, I'm too busy talking. I got to get that out because I have to tear it each time. I'm trying to be precise, and then here I am messing stuff up. That's down to 243, so that's pretty good. All right, so I teared it, so we're starting at zero again. It just takes a few seconds to measure it real precisely. And it's a little bit sticky. Okay, we're going to end up putting some of the tapioca on our baking sheet, so I'm just going to go ahead and do that. Since I had it in my measuring cup, and we're going to be putting some on our counter too, so take care of that. And then we need, I'm going to tear it, so we're starting at zero again, 120, so half that amount of cassava. So, you know, roughly a cup. Cassava and tapioca both are, can be really, how to say this nicely, binding to the digestive tract. So even though you're going to be tempted to eat multiple of these pretzels, I would highly recommend you only have one. At least one. Whoops. I don't remember where I go. One per day and see how your body does with it. Some people do fine with these flours, and other people, they find that they're just a little bit constipating. So make sure you're drinking plenty of water and that sort of thing. All right, we want six grams of salt, which again is roughly 3/4 of a teaspoon of salt. And then one packet of active dry yeast. Make sure my yeast is not expired. If I could read this. Oh my goodness, this is expired. 2019, wow, let me throw that out. I'm embarrassed to tell you how much yeast is in my cupboard, and almost all of it was expired, which I've been cooking with it, so I really think it's probably fine. But since I'm doing this recipe for you, I want to make sure it turns out. So, I found a packet that was not expired. So I'm just going to whisk these ingredients together. I'm going to go ahead and tear my scale. It's going to turn off all by itself. I'm going to use it, though, to measure out my dough to make sure I have roughly equal-sized pretzels. So I'll just leave it right there. So here's my dry. We're going to do that deal where you make a little well in the center. So basically you just kind of scoot your dry stuff up to the sides. And then we have our wet ingredients. So I have three large eggs that have been sitting out on the counter for about an hour to come up to room temperature. These are just kind of baking best practices to have some of your cold ingredients at room temperature. But it's not to say it's not going to work if you forgot to get your eggs out. It's just best. Okay, 1 tablespoon of honey. Notice I don't, if you have been here for a while, you know I don't usually measure a tablespoon of honey, a tablespoon of coconut aminos, things like that, because I don't want to have to clean the little measuring spoon. But because this is a pretty precise recipe, I've gone to the trouble to weigh my ingredients. I'm going to actually measure. So that was 1 tablespoon of honey. I need 2 tablespoons of avocado oil. It is my oil of choice for this recipe. You know what? I should have measured my oil first because then the honey would have just slipped out. You could also use, I would not use coconut oil, but you could use olive oil. And then we have some apple cider vinegar. We also need 2 tablespoons of this, and then 1/2 cup of tap water. And that'll be our liquid. So it's just like almost, oh, there's my rubber band. Almost all of the paleo baking is like a quick bread method where you have your dry, you have your wet, you mix them together, boom, you're done. In this case, we have a little bit more work to do because we're making pretzels, but it is still basic like that. You really don't need to get your mixer out for this. Okay, I need 1/2 cup of water. So I'm just going to whisk these together. While I whisk, I'll drink some coffee, I'll smile. Just breaking up those eggs. I do actually need to get one more egg out because I need to make an egg wash for these. I don't need to. It's not necessary. However, it'll help my pretzels have that nice, pretty shiny texture or surface, I guess, that you're used to with a soft pretzel. So I'm going to just start bringing the flour in. My child, who's driving, has to text me when he arrives at his destination. So he was texting that he had arrived at work. Like I said, these flours, you know, they act kind of sticky in your body. Well, they're kind of sticky in real life, too, outside of your body. And it is, believe it or not, even though it seems to be taking a little bit longer, it's easier to get everything incorporated well when you go slowly like this, rather than just like dumping the liquid right into the dry and just going to town, stirring it up or with a hand mixer or something. It's going to help everything to incorporate better. And again, because the flours are kind of heavy and stiff, you really want to mix your wet ingredients in a separate bowl. You know, if you've been here any length of time, I love a shortcut and I don't want to make a recipe any longer or more complicated than necessary. So oftentimes, even if, you know, the way Grandma wrote it, it would have said to mix the liquid in a separate bowl and then add them together. I often don't do that because it's just not always necessary. With this recipe, it's best practice to do it that way. And you saw I did it largely with that spatula, but now I'm having to get my hands in there and to really feel confident that I have it mixed thoroughly. I'm not really kneading. Well, I guess technically this is kneading a little bit, just lightly, just making sure it's mixed. And you can see I don't have flour on my counter here. I have this little bit right here, but I don't have any here, and it's not sticking. It's a really nice dough. Now, I want it to chill for about 10 minutes before I move forward. So I'm going to put this in my bowl. I'm actually going to put it outside because it's super cold outside and my refrigerator is full. So I'm just going to set this outside while I do some other things here. So I'm in North Carolina and not the mountains of North Carolina. So we don't get a ton of snow. We usually get a little bit of snow every year. But we have had snow for the past 3 weekends. It's our third Saturday in a row of getting up and having snow, which is crazy for here. In December, it was in the 70s most of the time. It was really, really nice and warm. I kind of wanted it to be a little cooler for Christmas time. But we're getting the cool now. It's very cold. So it's definitely colder than my refrigerator outside right now. So my dough can chill. Okay, so this is my egg wash. Set that aside. I'm just going to get rid of the stuff I don't need anymore. Okay, so I have my egg wash, which if I happen to have a pastry spoon, we're working on this child of mine doing dishes well. We're having some issues. If you have some tips for how to get your kids to actually do their chores properly, I'd love to know. So we have our egg wash with a pastry brush, and then this is my Malden sea salt. I can link this. I bought it on Amazon. It's from England, I believe. Yeah, maldensalt.co.uk. It's a real pretty flake salt. It has a nice taste, and it's what I do for, like, finishing salt. Like, if you do ever, like, a bar cookie with salt on top, something like that. Actually, I have a recipe on the website called Silos Cookies, which are modeled after a cookie that we had at the Silos, Magnolia, the Silos in Waco, Texas, and they had just a little bit of salt on the top, and oh, it's so, so good. Those are like a, I don't use peanut because we have peanut allergies, I use almond, but it's like a peanut butter oatmeal chocolate chip kind of cookie with that little bit of salt on top, really good. Anyway, so here is what I have for finishing up my pretzels at the end. I have my bench scraper. Actually, let me move things over because I need my burner. Okay, so pretzels, soft pretzels. You probably didn't know this if you just always bought one at the ballpark or amusement park, that kind of thing. But they are special. They're special in that you have to boil them. It's the same thing with bagels. If you ever, I'm assuming if you're watching this, you're not eating gluten anymore, so it's probably been a long time since you've been in a bakery or like a bagel shop. But you would sometimes in the bagel shop, at least the one here where I live, you would actually see them boiling the bagels. It's the same process. In fact, it's the same dough, at least for my recipe. This pretzel recipe came from a bagel recipe. I made bagels first. They were so good. I was like, this is the same texture as a soft pretzel. Well, sure enough, just a few tiny tweaks, then they became soft pretzels. So they get boiled. With a bagel, there's like some honey in the water. With soft pretzels, we put baking soda in the water. So my recipe says 10 cups of water and 2/3 of a cup of baking soda. Just fill up your pan with water, enough to be able to put 2 or 3 pretzels in there without it overflowing. And then 2/3 of a cup of baking soda. So I'm going to measure this. This one is just about empty. So I have my little burner on, and so that water will be coming to a boil and hopefully be ready for me when I'm ready for it. Okay, so at this point, I'm going to preheat my oven to 375. Let me just change that because I don't have that written that way. Okay, my dough is chilling. I have my water bath getting ready here. It helps so much for your cooking to not be stressful if you are just ready. You know, have your ingredients out, have your tools out, and then hopefully it won't be stressful when you're ready to start cooking. All right, so here's my tray. I've lined it with, this is nonstick, but I still lined it with parchment. It just makes my life easier. You saw me, I sprinkled that little bit of tapioca on it. What I'm gonna do actually is shape my pretzels and lay them on there kind of while they're waiting for their turn in the water bath. And then I will put them back on there to bake. So I'm getting a lot of tools out. I've got a spatula. I have this long-handled wooden slotted spoon. I've got this flat whisk, all of which might work well to get my pretzels out of that water bath. So I'm just trying to be all ready. I know I'm going to need a little bit more of this. Now I think I'm going to make 8 pretzels, but you can make however many pretzels you want. You can make them small, you can make them big, you can make those little like pretzel nuggets, whatever you want to do. Did I say that it's cold outside? It's really cold outside. Okay, it's math time. Ready? So we're going to do grams again just because it'll be more precise. Let me put my plastic wrap on and tear it out. I have 966 grams, 966. Does anybody want to do that math and tell me what that is divided by 8? So 120 grams. Okay, I'm gonna get close to it. Sorry, that's my recipe over here. I'm going to get close to it by just the fact that I have roughly a ball, and I'm just going to chop it in half, and half, and half. I know one of my halves is bigger than the other. It's not going to be exact, but we're going to have a good starting place. So what did I say I wanted? 120? That's 150. There we go, 120. I need date night ideas. So my husband and I have date night on once a week when the kids have something else that they're doing. But we have really gotten into a rut because we're like super laid back, kind of easy people. We don't go to fancy restaurants, hardly ever. We don't really need or want that. We occasionally will go see a movie, like if there's a new James Bond. We actually just saw that Kurt Warner story, American Underdog. Excellent movie. Highly recommend that. And look at that. Math works. Okay, so now we can get this out of the way. So we'll end up like getting takeout, or sometimes I'll even just cook. And then we watch TV. We like Masterpiece on PBS, so we'll watch one of those shows, or, you know, which is great. We're relaxing. We're spending time just the two of us, but it's not very exciting. So if you have really great date night ideas that are not super expensive, maybe something a little creative. We play a lot of board games. We have a lot of board games. So that is something, too. We're just not, we don't always have the energy for it. I would love your ideas, or just tell us what your favorite date night thing is. Okay, so I just make it a little rope. This is a little longer than a foot. I would say it's probably about 14 inches. So you're going to make it a U. So maybe from overhead camera show this. This is so not perfect and precise. I'm sure some expert pretzel maker would say this is terrible technique. But I make a U. I twist it twice. And then I just pull it over. And then I just kind of adjust it. And then I'll use my egg wash to press down. So it seals. And there is our soft pretzel. And this dough is, like I said before, it's really nice to work with. It's not super sticky. I have just this tiny amount of tapioca on my counter, maybe a teaspoon. I was thinking I would need my bench scraper for, you know, scraping the pretzel up or helping, you know, helping me pick it up. But it's just not that fragile. So you can see that my baking soda water is simmering. It is coming to a boil. I want it to really boil. And then I'm going to put my pretzels in, probably two at a time, because they will expand a little bit in there. And I have it fairly full. I use that shallow pan so you can see a little bit better. But you want your pretzel to just float up to the top. And once it floats up to the top, you take it out. If for some reason it doesn't float, if it's been in there for 2 minutes, you're going to want to go ahead and take it out. Put that baking soda in there will help create that lovely shiny crust that we want. And we're going to bake these. I don't remember. How long do you think? I want to say it was like 15 to 18 minutes because the bagels took way longer. They were like 30 minutes, but the bagels were way more dense as well. The pretzels did not take as long. So I'm kind of experimenting. I rolled this one out a little skinnier. Tonight we're going to have a beef and vegetable soup, and our pretzels are going to be like our bread. We're going to dip it in the soup. I just thought that sounded good. I was thinking, I don't even know what beer cheese is, honestly. I'm assuming it's like a cheese sauce that has beer in it. But I was thinking of soft pretzels. I was like, oh, we need some beer cheese. No idea where that thought came from. So I was thinking, we can just dip our pretzels in our soup. I'm just going to do a beef and vegetable soup. All right, so we're really boiling over here. I'm going to just give it a little zhuzh and make sure that the baking soda is all dissolved in there. And I'm going to just slide these guys in a couple at a time. And you keep an eye on those for me. Tell me what happens. Normally, I would set my timer, but I'm talking to you, and I'm doing this, and I'm keeping an eye on those, and my hands are dirty, so I'm not setting my timer. But you, especially if you're a mom, you probably have a good sense of how long a minute is. You could very easily add, so this one came up, add cinnamon and raisins, and instead of doing the egg wash with salt, you could then sprinkle some coarse sugar on top. That would be delicious and yummy. You could do the pretzel place at the mall. You know, I used to love those. That was like, I never did Cinnabon, but I loved those Auntie Anne pretzels dipped in butter. It was like the butter coated ones or something. So good. You could do that. So you could not do the egg wash and salt, and just when they come out the oven, dip them in butter. That would be delicious. Okay, it looks to me like we're floating here. Let's see if this guy works. Oh yeah, it worked really well. It's kind of flat, hence the name, flat list. They are a little fragile coming out of the water, so definitely be careful. Be gentle with them. You can very easily double this recipe, triple it if you're having a big crowd, or like I said, make them smaller. Super flexible. I'm just gonna leave them right there. You definitely want that flour, the little bit of tapioca on your tray before your pretzels have gone in the water, because then once you bring them out, they'll really be sticky, and that helps you to be able to kind of manipulate them around a little bit. Oh, now this one came apart. Just gonna get it real quickly. I just left him in there too long. It's okay. That's not the end of the world. We can fix it. Let me go ahead and finish this one. And then we'll get these last two in the water. And while they're in there, I'm gonna see if I can fix this guy. We're about to bubble over here, so. It's gotten so bubbly I can't see them in there, which is kind of funny. Okay. All right, let me clean this up so I can show you finishing them up. Okay, I'm gonna make sure they're spaced out a little bit, not touching each other. Okay, and we'll do our egg wash. I really hate an egg wash because it's just wasteful. I guess I could hunt out some tiny little like quail eggs or something. I just hate wasting. Y'all come up with something to do with it. If you have some clever thing you do with the leftover egg from your egg wash, tell me that too. That is what we are here for, is to help each other. Help each other figure things out. Help each other find the best plumbers and the best shoes and, you know, all that stuff. We need to support each other, build each other up, not try to keep all the good information for ourselves. So, if you have some amazing random tip that doesn't have to do with anything that we have talked about in this video, you can put it in the comments, because I can guarantee you, somebody needs to hear that. Okay, so here's my Malden sea salt. I have had this for probably 10 years. It's been a very long time because I don't use it that much. So, just a little salt right on top. It will stick because of the egg wash. Y'all, I showed you back at Thanksgiving time that Mom's Place gluten-free. I made her crescent rolls, and I have continued to make lots and lots of things with those products. My favorite have been the soup mixes, everything's gluten-free, obviously. The cream of mushroom and the French onion, those kinds of things, just adding that to recipes. It's like a great boost of flavor. It's kind of a cheater easy way to add some flavor. But she has soft pretzels as well, and I made those last weekend, and they were actually really good. Honestly, they're not as good as homemade, but they were faster, and they were very good. Okay, these are going in the oven for 15 minutes. That might not be quite enough, but you will know when they're done because they will have that beautiful golden brown that you know a soft pretzel is supposed to look like. So these are going in my hot oven. So I think I need to get a white apron. I like my red apron. I've had this one for a long time. But I cannot not get it dirty. So maybe if I had a white one, I could bleach it and it would look better. So sorry, y'all, but this is all pretzel right here. Aren't they beautiful? Don't they just look like the best pretzels you've ever had? These don't look gluten-free. These do not look paleo. They look amazing. So which one do I want? I think I'll tear into this one. This is the one that I kind of messed up. Remember, I let it boil just a few seconds too long. That's not a tricky process, but it's the trickiest part of the whole thing is when you're boiling them in the baking soda water. Not to let it go too long. But look, it's totally fine. Okay, these really are just out and they are super hot. But I wanted to break it open so I can show you that they're not cakey. They're not dry like a lot of gluten-free things. They don't taste like almonds. Did you see that? Let's do it in slow motion again. I'm going to break it open again. And you can kind of see how it... There's like there's a stretchiness to it that you get with gluten-containing foods, not gluten-free typically. It's the tapioca and the cassava that give it that kind of stretchiness. Oh goodness, years ago I made resurrection biscuits with my kids, and that video is on YouTube. That's when I was called Our Paleo Family. So if you search Our Paleo Family Resurrection Biscuits, I'll link it if I can. I can't remember how to link videos properly. But if I can figure it out, I will link that, which will make my kids mad because it's a really old video. But anyway, it's super cute. But we're making those resurrection biscuits at Easter where you tell the story of Jesus going into the tomb, and then you're putting a marshmallow in and they bake and the marshmallow melts and it's like, oh, the tomb is empty. But it's a cassava flour. I'm pretty sure it's cassava. Maybe it's just tapioca. Again, it has that chewiness that you just don't get with like an almond flour arrowroot type recipe. Anyway, I wanted to show you how amazing that texture is. Somebody asked me, it tastes so good. That yeast in there, even though we didn't really use the yeast to make our pretzels rise or anything, you get that flavor and it's so amazing. Somebody asked me if you could use this dough to make a pretzel roll. Yes, you certainly could. I think it would be hard to get it to cook properly on the inside. I would definitely use a lower oven temperature. We baked these at 375, 20 minutes. They came out just like this. I would definitely do a lower temperature, at least 350, maybe even 340. So it would be a little bit low and slow bake. But we did make sandwiches with these. So what I would do if I were you and I wanted to make a sandwich out of these, I would just make my pretzels less open, like this one. So I rolled it out thinner and we have more open structure. This was a little bit thicker. You see it's pretty closed in. Let it cool. Slice it just from this pretzel shape. I mean, that's going to be your best bet. How do you want to eat these? However you want. We're going to have some beef and vegetable soup tonight. But if you want to, you know, Super Bowl party and serve some kind of dip or whatever. But you know the classic with a soft pretzel is mustard. And I just want to show you. People think that we have this perfect diet. We never eat candy or any of that kind of stuff. We have a pretty good diet. Oops. But I believe that sometimes good enough is good enough. We don't compromise with gluten. We don't compromise with like poor quality oils, canola oil, that kind of thing. Never use that stuff. Never, ever. Gluten can't even come into my house. If I'm having like a party, people are bringing food, there's a no gluten rule. But we have some Chick-fil-A sauce in the fridge because they sell this at Walmart and it is delicious, okay? We have some Trader Joe's dill pickle mustard, which, you know, the ingredients in this are actually pretty decent. I think it has some flavor. Maybe not, actually. Man, the eyes. No, this one is actually pretty pretty pure ingredients. This is what I'm going to use, actually, just to put a little bit of mustard on here. Hey, a little bit of a fun condiment from time to time is not going to derail your diet. So good. My kids are at work. I told you I made these because one of them had been begging for them. I'm not sure there are going to be any left. Oh, wait. I can't eat them all, can I? It would mess up my stomach. Okay. I'll leave them a few. Okay, one last note on these pretzels. If you are not going to eat them all right away, serve them all to a party or something, I would freeze them. At the very least, put them in the refrigerator. They're very, very best when they're fresh. Like right now, they're at their very best texture. They'll be okay the next day, heated up. But by far, they're the best fresh. That's just the nature of these types of flours. If you're not going to eat them all now, say you wanted to make a double batch just because, you know, you're already in the process, go ahead and make a double batch. Definitely freeze them and then heat them up in an oven, air fryer, something like that. And they'll be delicious. Okay, those are the Paleo Soft Pretzels. Gluten-free, dairy-free, soy-free, all that stuff. Grain-free. Super fun for any time, especially Super Bowl time coming up. You can actually really work hard to make these look like hearts for Valentine's Day if you do cute things like that. I would really hope that you would subscribe to my channel. It will help my channel to grow. My goal is 10,000 subscribers this year, so help me get there, please. And when you subscribe, that helps me to know that you like these kinds of videos, that you like to see me showing you how to cook really yummy, tasty stuff that can actually improve your health. So thank you for watching. Thank you for subscribing, sharing, liking, all that stuff. Hope you have a great day, and I will see you back here in the kitchen next time.